Well, good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, everyone, and welcome to Bethel Church YouTube Campus. We are glad you're here this week. I'm Carmen, the church administrator, and I'm here to let you know about some things that are going on and to prepare us for today's service. First, join us for Christmas on Songbird Lane. Save the date, folks. Saturday, December 12th, we are going to be giving you a chance to gather with your family, your bubble, your life group, whoever, for a festive walk in the forest and other distance activities on Songbird Lane. Details and registration will be open for that in a few weeks. Second, our Upstreet families are doing a little contest this month. They are learning about gratitude, and families are being encouraged to send in a family video of them doing a touchdown dance as a shout out to how they are thankful for each other. Well, the staff decided to get in on the fun as well. Watch this. Thanks, Jamie. We had fun doing that, mostly because we kept dropping the ball. Oh, the wonders of movie editing. So, Upstreet families, here's what we need you to do. As a family, come up with your own touchdown dance. Record a video of it and email it to Jamie. Each submission will be entered into a draw for a gift certificate for your entire family to go out for ice cream. And remember, it was 19 degrees last week. The deadline for the videos is November 22nd, 2020, which is next week. Jamie will then put together a montage of all of the touchdown videos, and the winner will be drawn for the gift certificate on November 29th. And of course, the details are all in your Upstreet letter. So get those videos in, and you just might win some ice cream. Okay. Time to turn off the cell phones and put away the distractions and prepare our hearts for today's service. As we've already mentioned, today we begin a three-week foray into Paul's letter to Philemon, which has much to tell us about oppression, a serious topic which has been on everyone's minds these past few months. I'm going to start by reading the letter to you all, and then I'll pray, and from there we'll go to a video we've prepared which will open up the series for us before Mark comes on and delivers his message. So open your Bibles, please, to Philemon. We will start at verse 1 and read the entire letter. Paul, a prisoner for Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our beloved fellow worker, and Apphia, our sister, and Archippus, our fellow soldier, and the church in your house, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God always when I remember you in my prayers, because I hear of your love and of the faith that you have toward the Lord Jesus and for all the saints. And I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective for the full knowledge of every good thing that is in us for the sake of Christ. For I have derived much joy and comfort from your love, my brother, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you. Accordingly, though I am bold enough in Christ to command you to do what is required, yet for love's sake, I prefer to appeal to you. I, Paul, an old man, and now a prisoner also for Christ Jesus, I appeal to you for my child Onesimus, whose father I became in my imprisonment. Formerly, he was useless to you, but now he is indeed useful to you and to me. I am sending him back to you, sending my very heart. I would have been glad to keep him with me in order that he might serve me on your behalf during my imprisonment for the gospel. But I preferred to do nothing without your consent, in order that your goodness might not be by compulsion, but of your own accord. For this, perhaps, is why he was parted from you for a while, that you might have him back forever. No longer a bondservant, but much more than a bondservant, as a beloved brother, especially to me, but how much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. So, if you consider me your partner, receive him as you would receive me. If he has wronged you at all, or owes you anything, charge that to my account. I, Paul, write this with my own hand. I will repay it. To say nothing of your owing me even your own self. Yes, brother, I want some benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. Confident of your obedience, I write to you, knowing that you will do even more than I say. At the same time, prepare a guest room for me, for I am hoping that through your prayers I will be graciously given to you. Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus, sends greetings to you, and so do Mark, Aristarchus, Demas, and Luke, my fellow workers. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Let's pray. God our Father, I thank you for Paul. When he was Saul of Tarsus, he spoke approvingly of oppression, having made it his business to persecute the Christians of the early church. But in Christ, you freed him to become the advocate for the oppressed. Father, I pray, open our own eyes as we begin this series. Help us to see the injustices around us so that we can act to be part of the solutions. We ask this in the name of our just Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
So welcome, Sush, to our interview today as we begin our series on, I guess it's the broader topic is oppression, which has 1,000 different expressions to it. Of course, the most current in our culture right now is the issue of racism. But I want to welcome you, Sush, because you have a lot of knowledge in this area. You've been a huge help to us as a church in the last several months as we've been trying to get our head around this whole issue of racism, which is one form of course, of oppression. So maybe for those that are listening, they may not know who you are, your wife, family, whatever. Just give us a general introduction.
Thanks, Mark. Happy to be here and help the conversation move along. My name is Sush James, and I am the Equity and Inclusion Consultant for the Limestone District School Board.
Can you repeat that? What are you?
The Equity and Inclusion Consultant for the Limestone District School Board.
Okay.
And my partner is Kim James, and she is a high school teacher at KCBI. And we have 3 boys that all go here and to different schools in Kingston. And I grew up here at Sydenham, went to Sydenham High School, Harold Smith and Sydenham. And then went to Queens Phys Ed, and then I started coming to Bethel in the late 90s, we've been coming ever since, and together with Kim and I since the late 90s. So this is a home for us, and it's been great.
Okay. Well, so, Sush, you say that your role in the Limestone School Board is equity and inclusion. Now, I might ask you the question, but I'm going to ask you the question, what in the world do we need that kind of position for? For some people, they might say, isn't that like building an ark in the desert? Like, what's that all about?
There are 72 school boards, and it's becoming fairly clear. It's becoming very clear that across the 72 boards in our province that certain groups of students and families experience school differently. And it can be in terms of a sense of belonging. It can be in terms of mental health. It can be in terms of achievement. It can be in terms of pathways or jobs that they go into. It could also be in terms of all sorts of things like suspensions and that sort of thing. And so there's a reason for that. And the reason is that we've had a hard time serving all kids equally. And it doesn't matter what school board you're in. The data is crystal clear. And so in order to address those types of needs and tried to have everybody have the same type of access to all of these different types of things, try to have create an equal sense of belonging for everyone, no matter who you are in terms of race or what have you. It's turning out to be harder to do than we think.
Okay.
Because of a lot of different reasons. And so our board decided to create a full-time position and give full-time funds to address those gaps. It's a fairly unique, full-time model in terms of just equity and inclusion being 100% and not mixed in with other things, but that's the commitment our board made, and here I am.
So when you met with our leadership team, you said that one of the reasons why there's not equity and inclusion is obviously because of the issue of racism. And we had a really great chat about that. But one of the things that you said that surprised me was you said the biggest issue in Kingston, Ontario, for the race issue is discrimination against Blacks and Indigenous. You said that's the biggest issue of race. Could you explain that? Because some of us might go, well, we get the Indigenous issue. At least that seems to have captured the headlines a lot in the last decade or so. But the Black issue was a surprise for some of us.
Yeah, so, I mean, there's all sorts of oppressions in all of our systems, you know, and so there is, we have anti-Semitism, we have homophobia, we have the whole gamut. But the reality is, in terms of racism, and we have anti-Asian racism, we have all sorts of things, you know, coming out of the woodwork because of the COVID stuff and so on. But in terms of the history of Canada, and the what are, you know, sort of the quality of life that we have and what that's been built upon is directly related to anti-Indigenous and anti-racism, or anti-Black racism, you know, sort of in our history. And so we our board has started the conversation there. Because it's so ingrained in our beings, and so you know, the anti-Indigenous stuff is based on land and resources.
Yep.
Anti-Black racism came out of slavery and free labor and so on, and also not allowing certain things to happen, that luxuries that our ancestors or our sort of previous generations enjoyed that was not enjoyed by Black and Indigenous folks specifically and intentionally and over a long, long period of time. And we tend to think that anti-Black racism is a thing of the past.
Yeah.
With the civil rights movement or the KKK or, you know, burning crosses and stuff like this. But the reality is that there is a healthy dose to say of facts to say that, no, that is not the case. And in fact, whatever pieces of data that you want to look at in terms of, you know, pathways or outcomes or health outcomes or mental health or experiencing life in general, whether it be on the street, interacting with the police, or whether it's interacting in our schools, is that there's a clear difference in how folks experience our schools, with the most significant difference being with you know, Black and Indigenous students in our community.
Heart to break. So today we start a three-week series in the Book of Philemon. So I would invite you from wherever you're watching this to take your Bible and to turn to that book. And you might need to use your index in your Bible because this is a small little book, Philemon, but it's a very, very powerful little book. I want to just say also as we begin, thank you, Sush, for setting us up as we start to see the need that, of what we're talking about. And you're going to hear again from Sush in this message a little bit later on. Now, as you know from listening to my interview with Sush, one of the ways that this series will be applicable is in the area of racism. However, as we come to the book of Philemon today, and I'm going to use that as the basis of our series, Philemon is not a book about racism. It's actually about reconciliation, and it's particularly about slavery. But slavery, like racism, are interconnected. They are really both expressions of oppression. So while the dominant narrative in your mind and in our illustrations as we look at and interview various people on this issue of race will be on the issue of race, There are, unfortunately, an endless list of examples of oppression in our world today. So some of you will listen to this series over the next 3 weeks and make the application directly to the issue of racism. Others of you perhaps will think of slavery or sex trafficking, which is a worldwide problem in our, you know, in the world today, or sexism. Other expressions of oppression that unfortunately characterize our cultural narrative might be where the application points are for you. So as we begin, here are our perhaps our three goals as we look at the Book of Philemon over the next couple of weeks. We want to today look at the power of culture. The power of culture to desensitize us to the various forms and expressions of oppression. In the second week, we want to look at the power of the gospel. Not the power of public policy or the changing of laws or the changing of leaders, but the power of the gospel. That's the narrative we bring to the cultural narrative. And then in the third week, we want to look at the power of advocacy. All of these are illustrated in the Book of Philemon. And so as we come to Philemon, Paul is this great advocate. And as we look at advocacy in the third week, we want to see what we can do. And we realize that everybody's got different gifts. Everybody's got different passions. Everybody's got different callings in life. And so wherever you land on this issue of oppression, of how you want to address it, how you want to be engaged, how, we want people to say, it might look different for all of us, but we all want to be part of the solution. And it's our prayer that in this series, that God will do a work in our hearts, in my heart, just as the song that has just been sung invites us to pray. I love some of the words in that song, the lines, Lord, soften my heart, or open my eyes, or I surrender, or pierce through the dark, or cleanse every part of me, or I'm broken inside, I give you my life. And so we really want God to do a work in our hearts as a church as we move through this series. So hopefully you have found the Book of Philemon, little book, but let's begin by first of all just introducing some of the main characters in this book. And so Philemon, chapter 1, there's only one chapter, verse 1, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother. So Paul is really the speaker here as he writes this book. He's a prisoner of Christ Jesus. He's a prisoner in Rome. And Philemon is one of the pastoral epistles or prison epistles, along with Ephesians and Philippians and Colossians. And then we read on here to Philemon. And what is the relationship of Philemon to Paul? Well, he says, our beloved fellow worker. So Philemon isn't BFF, best friends forever kind of thing. He's a BFW, beloved fellow worker. He's a leader in the community. He's investing in the kingdom. And then it says, Apphia, our sister. It's a way of referring to our sister in Christ. Some believe that this is Philemon's wife. There's nothing to verify that absolutely, but that's what some people speculate. And then there's another character. I looked up the pronunciation of this guy's name, Archippos. Archippos is described as what? A fellow soldier. And so again, a terminology, you know, beloved fellow worker or sister or fellow soldier, the idea of Archippos is this contributor to the kingdom, a contributor to what God is doing in the city of Colossae, which this letter is addressed to. And then notice the very end, it says, and the church in your house. So that's the introduction. And those are some of the characters. But there's another character, but before he gets mentioned specifically, note where this text goes. As you look at verse 4, where does Paul go next? Well, you'll notice as we read here that he crops the picture and he focuses in on how awesome Philemon's love and faith is. This next section from verse 4 to 7 is believed to be addressing, in particular, Philemon. And so he writes, I thank my God always when I remember you in my prayers, because I hear of your love and of the faith that you have toward the Lord Jesus and for all the saints. So notice here just in verse 4 and 5 that Paul is kind of like pumping Philemon's tires. He's giving him a high five. He's affirming what God is doing in his life. And he is saying, you know, your faith is known. Your faith has been heard about. Your faith in Christ is public. Philemon isn't bashful or ashamed to, to demonstrate or declare his love for Christ. And then you'll also notice in verse 5, his love for others is public. And he's part of the leadership of the church, this house church. He's engaged, he's invested, he's caring for people. And then notice in verse 6, and I pray, Paul says, that the sharing of your faith may become effective for the full knowledge of every good thing that is in us for the sake of Christ. For I have derived much joy and comfort from what? Your love. And so Philemon has this public testimony of his love for God. There's a public testimony of his love for all the saints. And then the apostle himself says, Philemon, you have been an incredible encouragement to me. And then he ends off this section by saying, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you. So this guy Philemon is this incredible blessing to so many people. I love the word refreshed. For someone to be refreshing is kind of like when, you know, there are people that walk into a room or walk into a meeting and they can suck all the air out of the room, right? And you just wish they'd leave. And there are other people who are, they come into a room and it's like they give life and they give energy. And I think that's the kind of guy Philemon perhaps was. So when Paul thinks of Philemon, I think he has in mind a mature leader who is living with Christ at the center. Others are in the focus, are at focus. He's giving his life, his energy for the local church. He is no doubt, I would say, stewarding his time, treasures, and talents, as we say here at Bethel, in ways that are immense and powerful and are memorable. In fact, I would say that if you went to Colossae, where this church is believed to be, and if you were to interview people who had encountered Philemon in that house church, I think some people might say, you know, Philemon is the guy that, you know, when you're with him, he really, really cares about you. He's the kind of guy that perhaps makes you feel so welcome. He remembers your name. He's so generous. So why is Paul writing this letter? He's not writing it just to pump Philemon's tires, not just to encourage him, which it is a letter of encouragement. But that question, why is Paul writing this letter, leads to the fourth major primary character in this story. His name is Onesimus. And so listen to what we read. Note what we read, verse 8. Accordingly, though, I am bold enough in Christ to command you to do what is required. So, yet, for love's sake. So Paul's saying, what I'm about to say, I could command you to do it. Because Paul is a mentor, a spiritual leader here. But he's not going to command, and we'll look more at that in a couple of weeks when we look at advocacy. But he's not going to command you. Yet, for love's sake, I prefer to appeal to you. I, Paul, an old man, now in prison in Rome, also for Christ Jesus. I appeal to you. Second time he said appeal. I appeal to you for my child, using that term in a spiritual sense, Onesimus, whose father, spiritual father, I became in my imprisonment. And then notice what he says in verse 11, kind of a funny statement, but he says, formerly he was useless to you, but now he is indeed useful to you and to me. Kind of a play on the word Onesimus, or the name Onesimus. Onesimus is the name that means useful, and that was a common name for slaves, and that name would be given to them because that was what people wanted out of their slaves. They wanted them to be useful. And so Paul is kind of playing on that, saying, well, he was useless to you, but now he perhaps is useful to you. So let me give you a bit more of the backstory here, because this is where it gets to the crux of this letter, what Paul is writing for. Onesimus, at a certain time, was not a believer. And when he was not a believer, it seems like Onesimus stole from Philemon. That's why in verse 18, if you look at that verse, Paul says, I'll pay back whatever needs to be paid back, put it on my account. But as a result of Onesimus stealing something, we're not sure of all the details, the story goes that he likely fled to Rome. Thousands of runaway slaves, Onesimus seems to have been one of them, would flee to Rome, seeking to lose themselves in the imperial capital's teeming and nondescript slave population, kind of like it lost in the crowd. And so it seems that through some bizarre set of circumstances, Onesimus runs into or encounters or is introduced to Paul, and Paul somehow leads this guy to Christ. So who is Onesimus? Well, a lot could be said. But here's who Onesimus is. Onesimus is Philemon's slave. Now, just sit there for a second and think about this. Onesimus is Philemon's property. He is at least one of the slaves that Philemon apparently owns. We don't know if Philemon owned more, but in that culture, we could assume that he probably did. I mean, just think of this. This is Philemon who in the verse 4-7, Paul has just said, man, your love for God is public. Your love for the saints is public. Your love for me is significant. You have impacted my life. Yes, that Philemon is a slave owner. Philemon, this person who is described as a BFW, beloved fellow worker. Philemon, who Paul has just praised, owns a slave. And he owns at least one slave. Now, some of you might say, well, slavery, that form of oppression, was not the same as it is in America in that era of the slave trade. And that would be a true statement, because slavery back in the first century was not necessarily based on race. But listen to what slavery entailed. For example, prisoners of war during the first century, and when this letter was written, prisoners of war provided a steady supply of slaves for the Roman Empire. Some people were kidnapped and sold into slavery. Penal slaves existed to punish crimes committed against the state. If you avoided taxes or tried to skip out on military service, you could end up as a slave. Unwanted babies thrown on the street, claimed by someone else, could be raised to be a slave. Slaves did not choose their names. They were chosen by the owners, and thus Onesimus, slave of Philemon. By nature, slaves were persons, but from an economic standpoint, they were disposed of as property. So just get that. They were disposed of. They were looked upon as property. The head of a household could legally execute his slaves. And they would all be executed. All the slaves of a household would be executed if the head of the household was murdered. Slaves were not legally considered persons, but were tools of their masters. Philemon, whose love for God is public, whose love for the church is public, who has been such an encouragement to Paul, he is a slave owner. This beloved fellow worker. The Spirit of Jesus lives in Philemon, and he's a slave owner. Now, do any of you, as you're listening to this, there's a problem here, isn't there? There's a disconnect. In an article I read about indigenous oppression, the writer was talking about how culture can actually blind us. And he uses this illustration. He talks about mix salt into a clear glass of water and it dissolves. The entire glass is saline. The salt, though, has become invisible. And then he writes, he says, racism, or in our context, the broader issues of oppression, which could include racism, of course, and sexism and slavery and on, can be mixed into culture in a similar way. It's all around us, hidden in our histories. It is dissolved into our land and our laws, and like salt in water, so difficult to remove from our home and native land. Our prejudices tend to be shared because we swim in the same cultural water and we absorb the same messages. The cultural waters that Philemon was swimming in were vast, were deep, were like a massive ocean. Because according to some estimates, slaves constituted one-third, perhaps more, of the population. Slaves constituted perhaps close to one-third of the Roman population, which was just an accepted part of life. In Paul's day, slavery had virtually eclipsed free labor. So would you agree with this statement that the power of culture, we've stated up front, that's what this message today is about, but culture has the power to blind. That's one of the ways that it demonstrates power. It can blind us to seeing things that are quite obviously wrong. Culture has the power to blind, to desensitize us to what we should be very sensitive to cause us to perhaps be indifferent to what should break our hearts. And thus, as Sush said in the earlier video, some of our prejudices can be ingrained in our being. It just becomes second nature to us, our prejudices and acts of discrimination. And thus, we pray that song that was sung. We take that song that Will and Broncos led us in just earlier, and we pray that prayer, open my eyes or pierce through the darkness. Paul is wanting to wake Philemon up. He's wanting Philemon to get it. He's wanting him to see something that he is perhaps blind to. Philemon has been discipled by his culture on this particular example of oppression in his world. And so as you think of our world, 2020, we don't have 2020 vision on various issues of oppression either, do we? So before we become guilty of chronological snobbery, thinking that we've got it all figured out, we just need to look around in our culture at the waters that we swim in. I mean, listen to Sush as he talks about why we can have blind spots on issues of oppression. In particular, he's talking about racism. But listen to his just this two-minute clip on how we can have blind spots and why we can have blind spots as a result of the culture that we've been brought up in.
Here, but when you walk into a classroom of, say, adults, and you're saying, okay, I want to raise the awareness here of, let's say, the oppression of, like, racism, what's the biggest pushback you get? What's the biggest, tallest wall that you have to climb or barrier to help people get it? Is that...
The students are 100% engaged with this conversation. They want to learn. They're hungry to learn. I think the biggest challenge, and this is the challenge across every single workforce in Kingston that I've encountered, single institution, doesn't every single school. Doesn't matter if you're a separate school, French school, our school, Queen's University, St. Lawrence College. It does not matter.
Or a
institution. That's right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. The biggest challenge is that we grew up not learning our complete history of what our country is built upon. There's a ton, and this is just my own opinion, there's a ton to be proud of, to be Canadian, a ton. You know, if you were to ask my kids or myself what I identify as Canadian, I'm proud of it. But the reality is that we have not learned our full truth. And that becomes the biggest barrier to doing this work, because what we have to start to do with the adults, not the kids, is that we have to actually go back and unlearn certain things that were not completely true or not completely the total picture.
Yep.
And then relearn certain things, and then actually top onto that, have a whole bunch of new learning coming at it. Right?
Yeah.
And so you're unlearning, relearning, new learning the whole time. Mm-hmm. And that's hard. You know, that's a lot of work for adults. Yeah. And it doesn't matter what your education level is. It doesn't even matter what your politics are. We've all come from the same system, and we have the same unlearning, relearning, and new learning to do. And it's just work. It's just a lot of work.
Can you say that again? You said unlearning, relearning.
Relearn, and there's new learning.
And new learning, yeah.
I love what Sush says there. We grew up not learning our complete history. For me, that was true in terms of when I grew up and went to public school in the 70s and the late 60s. For many of us, we swim in the same waters. And I love the line, we need to unlearn some things. We need to relearn. And then we need new learnings to pile on top of all that. Culture has the power to blind. Thinking of this makes me ask, What am I blind to? What have I been desensitized to? What do I need to unlearn, relearn? And what are my new learnings? I know many of you at Bethel, and I know many of you probably listen to this, have been studying this issue of oppression, whether it's racism or slavery, sexism, you name it. And there's a lot of unlearning, and there's a lot of relearning, and there's a lot of new learnings that you've been working through. Paul is writing Philemon because he wants him to unlearn, relearn, and experience some new learnings. But Philemon is swimming in the culture of mass opinion on this issue in the first century. I mean, speaking of the power of culture, John Stackhouse says this, companies, he's speaking of our culture today, companies, schools, industries, media, courts, and legislatures increasingly decide everything by mass opinion, politics of the crowd. Well, the mass opinion or the politics of the crowd in Philemon's world is that Onesimus is his slave, that Onesimus is his property, and there is really nothing wrong with owning people. Culture has the power to blind. And so that's the context of what we're getting into. Now, as a Christ follower, if you are a believer in Jesus, would you be simply satisfied with the statement, culture has the power to blind? See, if it's just culture, then maybe we can fix the problem of our cultures with new laws, better policy, change the leaders. But as you think about that, the power of culture to blind, is there more going on than just the power of culture, just the mass opinion, the politics of the crowd? Listen to what Dr. Martin Luther King said in his monumental letter from Birmingham, the Birmingham jail. He says this, "We fail to understand or appreciate our systemic evil, the sin that permeates all human structures." Now, let me elaborate on that word sin to miss the mark. Sin is all-encompassing. It's cosmos permeating. It's creation destroying. And it is a force animated by Satan. That's part of the biblical worldview. If you take your Bible and just refer to some other writings of Paul or, of course, of Jesus, the life of Jesus, you'll see this. In Ephesians 2:2, Paul says this. He says, "And you were dead in your trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience." Paul is saying there's a spiritual reality, a dark side that is animated by Satan. And then, of course, in Ephesians 6, the classic text, our battle is not just flesh and blood. Our battle is not just good government, bad policy, good laws, bad laws, even though that's all really important to be addressed and to be corrected, no doubt. But Paul is saying there is more to the picture here than just physical. There's a spiritual backdrop. Sin is the evil that infiltrates the entire world. Sin energizes oppressive structures like fascism and racism and sexism and slavery and sex trafficking. Sin enslaves people, it enslaves animals. Sin enslaves the environment. Sin is slavery for all of creation. Read Romans. Consequently, creation needs liberation. Creation needs salvation. I mean, as you think about the world in which we live today, and as you think about some of these various expressions of oppression, has it ever crossed your mind when you look at something and you go, there's more at play here than just people being bad, people being selfish, people being greedy? That as you look at an issue, whether it's racism, for example, that has the ability to hang on and on and on in generation after generation and generation, and even after all this education and all of the good science, it just seems like some of these issues of oppression have a life that is hard to end. It's hard to extract it from our culture. It's hard to end it. And what explains that? Well, a biblical worldview says one of the answers to that question is that there is a demonic behind this. There is a force of darkness that is insidious. See, I think we'd agree with the statement, culture is the power to blind. But I think many of us would agree with the biblical worldview that what can energize and animate our blind spots or our dark, insidious aspects of our culture is sin, a destroying force animated by Satan. And so when we pray, your kingdom come, when we're inviting the presence of God to manifest himself in our culture, we understand invitation will result in confrontation because there's the prince of darkness. There's another kingdom trying to advance. And these various forms of oppression can be the fruit of the work of the kingdom of darkness. So Philemon is no different than you and I. He's living in a culture where many of its aspects are energized by the kingdom of darkness. But here is something that's even more troubling. Culture has the power to blind, yes. Culture has the power to blind because from a biblical worldview, aspects of culture can be energized by the demonic. I think we would all agree with that. But culture has the power to blind even the church. Notice here, Paul is addressing Philemon. He's addressing Christians in this letter. The church he's addressing. Christ followers can be blinded and desensitized, like Philemon, who need to be awakened. And it's really interesting at how at times the enemy used the oldest trick in the book, the twisting of Scripture, to somehow get a culture to endorse, say, racism or even sexism. It's the oldest trick in the enemy's book, playbook. If you look at Luke chapter 4, Jesus is tempted before his public ministry, just after his baptism, and there are three temptations. And in the second temptation, what does the enemy do? The enemy takes the Scripture and he throws it at Jesus, but he twists it all up in a contorted, perverted form, and he says, here's the Scripture, and he misuses it, he misapplies it, and what does Jesus do? He dismantles the perversion and the corruption of the text, he straightens it out, so to speak, and he foils the enemy's attempt at trying to take him down the wrong path. It's amazing how Scripture has been twisted to cause blindness. Interesting quote, many early U.S. slaveholders did not want their slaves to be exposed to Christianity for fear that they would be compelled to free them. Only in time was a distorted enough form of the Christian message available for us for use in sustaining slavery. I'm going to just read that again. Only in time was a distorted enough form of the Christian message available for use in sustaining slavery. Oh, let's not get too close to the Scriptures because it might compel us to free our slaves. But hold it. If we can twist the Scriptures somehow and see it from maybe just a cultural bias, a power bias, then perhaps we can justify slavery. And that's exactly what happened, the twisting of Scripture. Many Christian leaders abuse Scripture to endorse race-based chattel slavery. In some cases, whites condone practices so blatantly at odds with Christian ethics that there is no way their reading of Scripture could have been sincere, one author writes. In others, Scripture was selectively invoked to allow for what was called benevolent, kind slavery. That's kind of like me saying, let me stab you to death, but I will use a dull knife to do it. I won't use a sharp knife. I don't really want to hurt you. What sense does that make? Some theological heroes in America own slaves, including Reformed pastor Jonathan Edwards, who is widely acknowledged as one of America's greatest theologians and intellectuals, and yet he owned slaves. Now, he spoke against various forms of slavery, but he was a slave owner. One writer says this blindness was characteristic of many other Christian slaveholders. Solomon Northup, whose story was told in the 2013 feature film 12 Years a Slave, described the Baptist preacher who was his second master like this. This is how he describes his master, who was a pastor. In my opinion, there never was more kind, noble, candid, Christian man than William Ford. You could almost just stick in Philemon's name there. In my opinion, there was never more a kind, noble, candid Christian than Philemon. That's how Paul described Philemon. And then he goes on to say, the influences and associations that always surrounded him, William Ford, blinded him to the inherent wrong at the bottom of the system of slavery. And then listen to Harriet Jacobs, slave-turned-author. Jacobs recalls a happy childhood. She loved her white mistress and was well-treated by her. Indeed, Jacobs did not realize she was a slave until her mother died by the age of 6. But when her mistress died, it turned out she had broken her promise to set Jacobs free. So her Christian master said she would free her, but when she died, she didn't come through on her promise. In devastating lines that strike at the heart of Christian failure in the era of slavery, Jacobs wrote these words, "My mistress had taught me the precepts of God's word. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Whatsoever ye would that men should do unto you, do ye even so unto them. KJV. But I was her slave, she writes, and I suppose she did not recognize me as her neighbor. Given that Jesus' parable of the Good Samaritan answers the question, who is my neighbor, with a story of love across racial differences, the writer says, the failure of white Christians to recognize black people as their neighbors is absolutely without excuse. But the twisting of scriptures. John Newton, fascinating story there. We don't have time to go into that, but he wrote Amazing Grace. The slave trader comes to faith in Christ. And if you read the details on his life, he comes to faith in Christ, and he did not immediately give up slavery. He did not immediately give up slave trading. It took a while to extract that lie and that perversion and that oppression out of his soul, because John Newton, like all of us, swim in the stream of culture. And sometimes it's hard to see. Culture has the power to blind. Even the church. Animated by the enemy, subjected at times to the oldest trick in the book, twisting of scripture, culture that can have a loud, loud voice, the voice of the masses that have swayed whole nations and communities and even Christians to embrace various positions and beliefs that are contrary to the gospel, whether it's various forms of oppression or other kinds of issues. Well, there was no doubt that God was at work in Philemon's life here. No doubt that he knew Christ. No doubt that the Spirit of God lived in him. But he had a blind spot, indoctrinated by his culture, a product of his world. Now, Paul is going to challenge him. And as we'll see next week, he is going to challenge him like he's never been challenged before, with the power of the gospel and the implications of the gospel of how he should view his slave. But as we come to a conclusion today, I want us to think about some questions, and I want us to pray. This is a really important message for us as a church. This is a really important series for us, because we claim to be a church that responds to the heart of God, wants to transform the city, the nation, and the world. We claim a value that's called solidarity, coming alongside people. If we're truly responding to God's heart and wanting to touch a city, then we need to allow God to touch us on this issue and to expose anything in our hearts that would be part of the problem, not part of the solution. And so I want you to think about these questions and then pray together. If you're on your own, or if you're with a group, or even in your life group, perhaps take these questions and discuss them and then pray. But how has the power of culture blinded you to God's truth in the past? I've had lots of aha moments where I've said, you know what? I used to believe that. I don't believe that anymore. Actually, I was more influenced by culture and tradition than I was led by Scripture and the Spirit of God. In this area of oppression, what are evidences of the enemy at work? What would you say as you look at oppression all over the world, in North America, in Canada, in Kingston here, as Sush has explained? What do you look at and say, it's just so insidious? It's certainly a demonstration of what would seem to be a kingdom of darkness. And what have I had to unlearn? What have I had to relearn? And what are my new learnings? And then, after that discussion, pray for the advancement of God's kingdom against the kingdom of darkness. And perhaps go back to the song that Will and Broncos led and pull out some of those lines that just give us words to express our prayers, like, soften my heart, open my eyes, I surrender, pierce through the dark, cleanse every part, I am broken inside, I give you my life. Spend some time praying on those issues. And then finally, pray for the healing of those so deeply impacted by oppression. We're going to take some time next week to look at that, maybe think about that a little bit as we look at the power of the gospel. But as we conclude, there's another video here of Sush. It's just about a 5-minute video. And listen to him as I ask him the question, what does it feel like to live in an oppressed state whenever you walk into a room, maybe it's the color of your skin, your culture, your language, your gender, that you feel oppressed, you feel like an outsider looking in. Sush explains that from his own personal story and from just observations as he's involved in some education on this matter. But I want you to watch this video and then just sit in that for a bit. maybe talk about it amongst you. What would that be like? Some of you will be able to talk about that firsthand because you've experienced that. And then pray into that. Pray for God to bring healing. And perhaps for God to even lead you to those who are oppressed. And as we go into the next week and the week after, the power of the gospel, the power of advocacy, perhaps God will begin to solidify some action steps for you as we look more deeply into this issue. So may God work in our hearts on this issue. Philemon needed an aha moment. He needs a wake up. And I need a wake up. Many of us need a wake up on this issue. We need to care deeply about issues of oppression. So may the Spirit of God work in our hearts in these days as we seek to love people who are made in God's image and have infinite worth. And so God, work in our hearts as we now watch this next video clip. And as groups and as individuals, we talk amongst ourselves, we talk about these questions, we pray into these issues. We pray and ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
There's a clear difference in how folks experience our schools, with the most significant difference being with Black and Indigenous students. Yep. In our community for a variety of reasons.
Yeah. So could you paint a bit of a framework, maybe two or three words that would kind of describe the experience of a student, because you're working in the Limestone School Board, a student who is Black or is Indigenous, walks onto the campus, goes to recess, has lunch, sits in the classroom. What's that? What can that feel like when there's that kind of prejudice or discrimination going on? That's just part of the oxygen that we breathe, that we don't even know necessarily, but that Black person or that Indigenous person is super, super aware of what's going on. What can you give us some words that might describe, what's that feel like for that person?
And this can extend to other identities too.
Oh, for sure. Yeah.
Other, in particular in Kingston. And it doesn't matter where, and this would extend outside of schools too. It doesn't matter if you're at a separate school board, a French school board, our school board, whether you're at Queen's University, whether you're at RMC, St. Lawrence, or what have you, City of Kingston, like any of the, it doesn't matter. It there in Kingston, one of the words could be loneliness.
Mm-hmm.
Not feeling like there's anybody that understands us, you know, that type of thing. Another word you could maybe say is erasure or representation. In the places that, again, the hospitals, Queens or schools or places in this, just any sort of institution within the city of Kingston, there doesn't seem to be some these representations of different folks, and we don't necessarily learn about, people don't. We learn about a certain type of history. We don't learn about the full history.
Okay, so you talk about the loneliness or kind of feel like the outside looking in. Can you just talk a little bit about that from a personal experience? You grew up in Sydenham. So, right. And I remember when you told me that, it was like, wow, you grew up in Sydenham. So that wasn't always easy, correct?
No, Sydenham has been a great spot in terms of growing up for a lot of reasons. And my closest friends are still Sydenhamites, but again, you go through these bouts of what I would say is loneliness and not feeling like you quite belong. You don't quite know what it is necessarily, but eventually you figure out it's, color of skin, it's culture, it's these types of things that you're just not the same as everybody else. That takes a toll on you. you know, that does take a toll, and yeah. you want to assimilate to the best of your ability, you know, and it is not like, you know, folks in Sydenham are more racist or less racist,
no.
You know, like than anyone at Queen's University or anywhere else in Kingston for that matter.
Oh.
It looks we're equally in this culture. It looks a little different in different places, but you know, there were certainly bouts of overt racism and growing up, and no one necessarily really to talk to about it.
Yeah,
you know, and that's something that we'd like to change for future generations.
So it's an interesting word you use. It takes its toll. Like it's an emotional, physical, spiritual, mental wear on you. You would say,
yeah. I think racism is it is a type of oppression. It is a type of, and we are now starting to learn that it is a type of trauma on folks that we never really, and trauma, and as you said, mentally, socially, and spiritually,
yeah.
You know, and which is why we're talking right now, I suppose.
Yeah.